You know, we've come so far since my inauguration. On that day, I told you, as I stood in that winter, we stood in a winter of peril and a winter of possibilities. Peril and possibilities. We were in the grip of the worst pandemic in a century. The worst economic crisis since the Great Depression. The worst attack on our democracy since the Civil War. We came together as Americans. We got through it. We emerged stronger, more prosperous, and more secure. Today, we have the strongest economy in the world, creating nearly 16 million new jobs, a record. Wages are up. Inflation continues to come down. The racial wealth gap is the lowest it's been in 20 years. We're literally rebuilding our entire nation, urban, suburban, rural, and tribal communities. Manufacturing has come back to America. We're leading the world again in chips and science and innovation. We finally beat Big Pharma after all these years to lower the cost of prescription drugs for seniors. And I'm going to keep fighting to make sure we lower the cost for everyone, not just seniors. More people have health care today in America than ever before. And I signed one of the most significant laws helping millions of veterans and their families who are exposed to toxic materials. You know, most significant climate law ever, ever in the history of the world. The first major gun safety law in 30 years. Today, the violent crime rate is at a 50-year low. We're also securing our border. Border crossings are lower today than when the previous administration left office. I've kept my commitment to appoint the first black woman to the Supreme Court of the United States of America. I also kept my commitment to have an administration that looks like America and be a president for all Americans. That's what I've done. I ran for president 4 years ago because I believed and still do that the soul of America was at stake. The very nature of who we are was at stake. And that's still the case. America's an idea stronger than any army, bigger than any ocean, more powerful than any dictator or tyrant. It's the most powerful idea in the history of the world. That idea is that we hold these truths to be self-evident. We're all created equal, endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights, life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. We've never fully lived up to it. I made my choice. I've made my views known. I would like to thank our great Vice President, Kamala Harris. She's experienced, she's tough, she's capable. She's been an incredible partner to me and a leader for our country. Now the choice is up to you, the American people. When you make that choice, remember the words of Benjamin Franklin's hanging on my wall here in the Oval Office, alongside the busts of Dr. King and Rosa Parks and Cesar Chavez. When Ben Franklin was asked, as he emerged from the convention going on, whether the founders have given America a monarchy or a republic, Franklin's response was, a republic, if you can keep it. A republic, if you can keep it. Whether we keep our republic is now in your hands. My fellow Americans, it's been the privilege of my life serve this nation for over 50 years. Nowhere else on earth could a kid with a stutter from modest beginnings in Scranton, Pennsylvania, Claymont, Delaware, one day sit behind the resolute desk in the Oval Office as President of the United States. But here I am. That's what's so special about America. We're a nation of promise and possibilities, of dreamers and doers, of ordinary Americans doing extraordinary things. I've given my heart and my soul to our nation, like so many others. I've been blessed a million times in return with the love and support of the American people. I hope you have some idea how grateful I am to all of you. The great thing about America is here, kings and dictators do not rule, the people do. History is in your hands. The power is in your hands. The idea of America lies in your hands. You just have to keep faith, keep the faith. And remember who we are. We're the United States of America. And there's simply nothing, nothing beyond our capacity when we do it together. So let's act together. Preserve our democracy. God bless you all. May God protect our troops.
The U.S. President Joe Biden live from the Oval Office, and you'd have to say that was a thank you and a goodbye from President Joe Biden. And you'd have to also say that that was 13 minutes that he struggled to get through, even with auto cue. Joe Biden there saying that he is stepping aside, essentially, because he's a believer in democracy. He wants to stop the division and he wants to hand over to a new generation. I want to bring in Annalise Nielsen now, Paul Murray, Trudy McIntosh. Annalise, first to you. He did struggle to get to it. It was as if to confirm that this was a decision he made to stand aside that should have been made months ago. He appeared more frail. He appeared to struggle through that at times. And look, frankly, it looks like that his team has had to put a lot of makeup on him just to seem like he's got a bit of bounce back.
Yeah, look, it had all the hallmarks of a resignation speech without the resignation, and it seemed like he was more resigned to his fate but not going anywhere, which I think is probably where we are now. He said he's going to be there for another 6 months, and I don't disagree with you at all. That really sounded like he was struggling to get through that, and at a few moments I simply couldn't understand what he was saying. And this is not in isolation. I say this again because we've been saying it for the last few years. This is not a bad day. He has a stutter. We forgive the stutter. We all misspeak sometimes, but this has been a consistent pattern of behaviour for a long time. And I don't think anyone's going to be looking at that with much confidence. And then the flip side of that is, and what we're hearing a lot from especially Republicans on Capitol Hill, is they're saying our adversaries are watching this. And this looks like a weak moment for America right now. It looks like a vulnerable moment. And that's going to be the discussion over the next few months. Depending on how much we see him, he might really just go back to not doing much media. Why does he have to if he's not running again? We might just start seeing a lot more of Kamala.
Yeah, I think we will be. And after that performance, you take your mind back to the debate, the subsequent interviews that were meant to alleviate any concerns. That did nothing. And I think even this performance today, Paul, he looked even more frail than he did a couple of weeks ago. Yes, he has had COVID. He's just come out of isolation. We saw him quite unsteady on his feet as he arrived back at the White House yesterday. But this is not going to help him in any way in terms of his political opponents saying, well, if it's not right for you to run for a second term, how can you be okay to run even for this next 6 months till January?
He was a weak, diminished and pathetic figure. We understand what has been happening and we understand that emotionally for anyone to give up a dream job is a difficult thing to do. You saw in what he said that I deserve a second term, however I've decided to unite my party and therefore to unite my party. That's all he says. He doesn't say I'm therefore getting out of the way. Instead, it's the pass the torch stuff. But that was a white knuckle ride. Is he going to finish the sentence? Is he going to finish the word? And I don't say that as hyperbole about a person who, if I had a vote, would never have voted for him. That was frightening to watch. That is the President of the United States who still has all the power of the presidency until January 20 of next year. Now, I know there's political consequences if Harris becomes the president and running against the sitting president, blah, blah, blah. But he also turned around and said that what he wanted to do in the next 6 months was to have Supreme Court reform. Now, that is something that is like one of the tippy top of the Democratic left shopping lists. Yeah. He's not going to be able to advocate for that or to fight for that. So what you saw was the battle between the ego of the man, the desperation of the people around him, the lie that we have been told increasingly as his health has deteriorated, and an inability to match the moment. This was frightening.